So, we just watched the classic Simpsons episode. What was it called?
Itchy and Scratchy. Marge.
Itchy and Scratchy and Marge.
Yes.
It's not as good as the later episode, Itchy and Scratchy and Poochy.
Oh.
Which is the high watermark for Itchy and Scratchy. Episodes. Yes, it's even better than Itchy and Scratchy Land.
This is, yeah, definitely.
Even though it features no bought license plates.
I think this is one of the best episodes of The Simpsons so far.
Yeah, I think it, other than that one, Three Cars in Every Lawn, Anything for Gary, I think this is the best one so far.
Or Bart Gets an F.
I think it's better than Bart Gets an F.
Yeah.
But yeah, so basically, if you haven't seen this episode for several years, Marge gets incensed watching Itchy and Scratchy once it's cancelled, gets it cancelled, but then sees the Michelangelo's David, realises that she can't go against some art but not others just for being lewd, and then everything's restored.
Yeah, everything returns to the status quo.
Yeah. But yeah, we're getting a bit more satire into the show.
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
It's taking the piss out of comedy writers.
Yeah.
Which they would do over and over again.
Cartoons in general.
Yeah.
All about, because at the time of the 90s there was a whole thing about TV will make you dumber, and TV's a bad influence on kids and it's ruining children and etc. Basically the same stuff you hear now, but in relation to like the internet and video games.
Yeah.
TV was kind of like the
whipping boy.
The whipping boy at the time, yeah.
Yeah.
There's a very, very good spoof of Psycho.
Yes, there is.
Which I guess back in the day would have been quite innovative and a bit different.
Exactly. This was before Psycho was shot for shot remade by Gus Van Sant.
God. Yeah. Jesus fucking Christ. But I like that. I like that film reference. That's a good one.
It is. They're doing more elaborate film references. There was. There's been some before. There was a 2001 reference. One of the earlier ones. No, a Kubrick reference in Bart the General.
It's Full Metal Jacket.
Yeah. Sorry, not 2001.
Yeah.
But yeah, we're. It's getting better.
This
is better than Bart versus Thanksgiving.
Oh yeah, I love that.
Or Bart the Daredevil.
Ironically, I didn't realise this, but like we put our Bart the Thanksgiving episode up like a week before Thanksgiving.
Hey!
So we kind of timed it.
Exactly.
That was
no wonder that one was so popular.
Yeah, all part of a plan.
Yeah.
No, I think it was a great episode. Yeah. I think it raises a lot of interesting debate about whether media is responsible for bad behaviour in children.
Where do you stand?
It's not.
I agree.
there's no scientific evidence proving it whatsoever. Like, I love Grand Theft Auto. I'm not going to go out and murder a whole bunch of people.
You're not?
No.
Alright. Yeah, I agree. There's no actual basis for that at all. No. I think it's just a stupid thing to argue.
All it is just parents wanting to blame other things and not blaming themselves.
Yeah, it's bad. If your child is a murdering psychopath, it's probably your fault or some fact other than...
Or it's got some mental health problem.
That's true.
You know, that just can't be helped.
Yeah.
But I don't necessarily think that. I think if you're a mother complaining about, like, violence in Grand Theft Auto that your son's playing, well, guess what? You shouldn't have bought your son Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah.
You know, there's like age ratings on things for a reason.
Yeah.
Like, I literally don't understand, like, oh yeah, I have all these video games, they should have more warnings, I'm sorry, but on the new Call of Duty game, there's a big fucking massive 18 sticker on it.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not going to buy my child a copy of Call of Duty.
No.
I'm just not going to do it.
Well, you would, it's irresponsible to do so, isn't
it? Very irresponsible, yeah. But I think parents and certain groups are always looking to blame something else except for themselves. So it was TV back in the 90s, it was rock and roll back in the 70s, and it was, I guess it's video games of the internet now.
Yeah.
Video games of the internet are the harbinger of the death of civilization.
Yeah.
But very much the 90s situates it where it's TV and cartoons.
This would have been a similar time, don't quote me on this, as Ren and Stimpy.
I think Ren and Stimpy was a few years away,
it seems to be that kind of milieu.
Yeah, milieu.
Yeah.
Well, it's when cartoons would kind of get a bit more edgy.
Yeah.
But even like Even something like Tom and Jerry.
Oh, yeah. That's...
Like, Tom and Jerry's really violent. Obviously, the main spoof point for Itchy and Scratchy, but Tom and Jerry's really violent.
It is.
And I guess Tom's, like, a bad role model because he smokes as well.
He does it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, actually, Hanna-Barbera, slash, what, basically Warner Brothers, who I think own Tom and Jerry these days, you can correct me on that if you want. They've actually gone back and digitally altered episodes of Tom and Jerry to remove Tom from smoking cigars.
Really?
How stupid is that?
That is pretty pathetic.
Because it's just a thing of the time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it's like in Tom and Jerry, there's a racist black maid in it.
Yeah.
But, like, you kind of can't get around it because it's a product of its time.
Well, I think that's disingenuous anyway.
Well, it's disrespectful
to
to the integrity of the original cartoon.
Yeah.
Because, like, back in the day, what everybody smoked, it was just a thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, people back, I guess, didn't know any better than to have a racist black maid in it. You know, it was just...
But it's stupid anyway, like, just raise kids to never know that was a thing.
Exactly, yeah. It's like you need to sit down and, like... it's like in old Disney movies.
Yeah.
You know, like in Peter Pan, there's like the racist Native Americans.
Oh yeah.
What's the song? What makes the red man red? Or like the crows in Dumbo.
I've never seen either of those.
Oh my god.
Some of us didn't have childhoods.
Well, there's some racist black crows in Dumbo, and they're like it's like. I don't want to just go on YouTube and watch it. It's pretty hard to watch these days.
Is it?
Yeah, yeah. It's like, I ain't never seen anything, but I ain't seen no elephant blah. It's like, oh dear.
That's pretty bad.
But they're comically racist. But it's a product of the time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like you just can't if you're gonna introduce these cartoons to kids, like you just can't get around it. It's like recently they've re-released all the old like Mickey Mouse cartoons on DVD.
Yeah.
And Leonard Maltin, who actually does get a name check in an episode of The Simpsons, has been the handsomest critic on TV, handsomest film critic on TV. He actually does like a little introduction to the cartoons, saying, you know, obviously these are classics and these are unaltered, these are just as they were released. But because of that, there's slightly questionable elements.
Yeah.
And he explains what the questionable elements are in quite a frank manner and just takes you through it so you can understand the kind of historical context. And you're quite right, you can't kind of blind kids to the fact that at one point, you know, there were like racist black Bambi characters or obvious stereotypes or Tom smoking or drinking. And
As long as you teach him it's bad.
Yeah, exactly.
There's no wrong with it.
Yeah, yeah. Or like I said, you explain that it's, you know, product of the 50s, product of the 40s, and we've come a long way since.
Yeah.
So, well, I guess except for something like Transformers 2, but we've seemingly come a long way since then.
Yeah.
But this episode of Itchy and Scratchy and Marge kind of touches upon those issues, I think, a bit. I think there's no connection at all between.
No.
I just think that, you know, personally, I think the parents should take more responsibility.
As do I.
Oh, wait, I probably should have bought my 7-year-old son Little Big Planet and Rayman instead of Grand Theft Auto and Call of Duty.
Yeah.
Oh, but Mum, all the other kids are playing Call of Duty. Well, guess what? I'm not having it over Mum or Dad. I'm not getting any Call of Duty.
Yeah. Simple. Well, it's just parents having no willpower at all to say no, isn't it?
Yeah. It's like, and illegal as well, pretty much.
Yeah. Well, it's, yeah.
Because even though they're...
Well, it's legal. If a parent does it,
if a parent does it, yeah. I don't know, it still doesn't... Because basically...
It is legal, though, because they're just guidances.
Yeah, but it's like a bending of the rules, isn't it? Because basically the store clerk knows that the parent's buying it for, like, a 10-year-old son or something.
Well, it were in news recently, because, like, they can't legally, even if they went and buying it for him, it's fine. Because they're parental guidances, they're not a strict enforcement. Mm. If you play an 18 or watch an 18 film at home, it's not illegal.
No. But like, it's illegal for somebody to, like, sell a ticket to somebody for an 18-rated film who's under 18.
Yeah.
So in the same way it's legal to buy alcohol or...
Yeah.
So it's like the BBFC have age ratings in place for a reason.
Yeah.
You know, and if you ever go onto the BBFC website, it's actually quite interesting.
Yeah.
If those are Americans who don't know or you're dealing with the UK, BBFC is kind of like a... The MPAA's rating system over here.
Yeah.
You've got U, and which is for everybody. PG, which is borderline questionable material, but not really. It's still suitable for kids, like the Simpsons level, basically. And then there's 12, so you can't go, you can't buy
12A, there isn't a 12 anymore.
No, there is on DVD.
Oh, yeah.
12A is only for cinema.
Yeah.
Like, you could legally go see Guardians of the Galaxy, for example, in the cinema, but you may get ID'd for buying the DVD.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? And then there's 15, so if you're under the age of 15, you can't legally buy the film. And then there's 18.
Yeah.
And then there's R18, which is pornography.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like Nymphomaniac. And
yeah.
Like NC-17, I guess.
Yeah.
But this episode kind of tapped. It's a good little launch point of an episode for discussing kind of these wider issues, I guess. And yeah. It's always a prevalent issue. And I think this episode's always kind of going to stay relevant.
Timeless.
Yeah. But I think this episode's really funny as well.
It is really funny.
I love the interviews that Ken Brockman does.
With Marvin Monroe.
Marvin Monroe makes a return, yeah.
I'm hoping this is his... I think we're going to get close to the last appearance of him.
We're getting close, yeah. Yeah, there's not many more he's in now, I think. I think at this point they realised he wasn't a very popular character.
No.
Or very funny.
No.
Well,
there's the one where... Now, what people might have missed this, it's a very subtle little thing, but in the one where Maud Sanders dies,
oh, yeah.
Pass over his gravestone.
Oh, do they?
Yeah.
Ah. Good, so he died.
I think he's next to Bleeding Comes Murphy.
I love that joke in the 137th episode Spectacular where it's like... which two popular Simpsons characters died this year? And show the silhouette of Bleeding Gums and Dr. Marvin Monroe. And he says, if you said Dr. Marvin Monroe and Bleeding Gums Murphy, you were wrong. They were never popular. that's great.
Yeah.
But I think this episode's full of really good laughs as well.
It is.
I like... I love the cartoon they do where they kind of like bastardise Itchy and Scratchy.
That's the funniest point so far, I think, for the Simpsons.
Yeah. That's so funny. Yeah, it's like, you want some lemonade?
Yes.
How much would you like?
A cupful.
Okay.
It's the eyes. The eyes
yeah, best. So funny.
And Itchy's got the like really weird like eyelashes.
Eyelashes. And they kind of look off into the distance out and be like, please. You made the best lemonade, Itchy. Ah, thank you, Scratchy.
Yeah, it's hilarious, is that one.
And it's got the classic sequence where all the kids go out and rediscover the outdoors as well.
Yeah.
I really like that scene.
So overall, pretty great episode.
Yeah.
What would you give it out of the 10? I would give it a 9.
I think it's a 9, yeah.
Yeah, it's not one of the best episodes. Not enough Milhouse.
Epi's coming up Milhouse. Now it's borderline, but it's very close to being a 10. I think
it's very close to being a 10. Just doesn't have that thing. It moves very quickly.
Yeah.
No B-plot in it at all, no. Really.
They cram a lot in there. Like I said, it raises all sorts of interesting debates about media and its relationship to kids growing up and to whether it affects them or not.
Yeah.
That's
it, really.
Yeah. Very good.
Pretty great episode. Not the best so far. Nearly the best. Not the best to come.